We hold these truths to be self-evident.
That all men are created equal.
As a member of Congress, I get to have a lot of really interesting people in the office. Experts on what they're talking about.
This is the podcast
for insights into the issues.
China, bioterrorism, Medicare for all. In-depth discussions.
Breaking it down into simple terms. We hold these truths. With Dan Crenshaw.
The eagle has landed.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm here with Mayor Francis Suarez, Mayor of Miami. And, you know, we've become friends over time, seeing each other, various events and other occasions. And it's awesome to be with you, Mr. Mayor. This is going to be a cool podcast.
Congressman, it's a privilege. I have not been called Francisco many times in my life, so that's awesome. That's a good start. But I was, you know, I'm the oldest of four, and I was named after St. Francis of Assisi. Or St. Francis Xavier. St. Francis Xavier founded the Jesuits, and St. Francis of Assisi founded the Franciscans. So as a Catholic, you know, the Francis name right now is on a roll because the Pope's name is Francis. So we're having our moment in the sun right now.
Man, you know, it's finally the time of the Francises. It was also, didn't they call Frank Underwood from House of Cards Francis?
That's right. I don't know about that one, but yeah. We can call him Francisco if you want.
Yeah, I'll call him Francisco. All right. So we're going to cross-post this to your podcast as well. And the name of your podcast is?
Cafecito Tech Talk. And usually what we do in my podcast is, you know, we sort of talk about the Miami story. I think in the Miami story is also about sort of the urban America story, right? Like what's happening in urban America? Why are some cities succeeding while other cities are not? And, you know, I've read a lot of your stuff. Obviously, I truly admire your service to this country. I'm a frustrated wannabe Navy SEAL that never actually did it. Unfortunately, I should have. I mean, if there's any regret that I ever have in life, it's not having served in the military. And I think those of us in this country who do it and do it at the level that you've done it really deserve our greatest thank yous, because, you know, we marvel at, you know, you were talking to me about this background, right? It's not a virtual background.
Fake background.
Definitely a fake
background.
The peace and prosperity that we have. But we sometimes forget about the sacrifice and the people who put their lives on the line to ensure that peace and prosperity. And it's one of the tragedies sometimes of our American system is that we're just not that grateful.
It is funny. I mean, for our YouTube watchers, apparently this background is not fake. It looks too good to be true. It looks too well lit. I mean,
You're gonna make me do this. Here we go. That's my office. There are the lights.
Yeah, that's not proof though. You just proved that you're in a studio. I definitely think those are LEDs.
Now it makes it look like I'm in the metaverse, right? Am I in the metaverse?
Yeah.
It does. I did give you a 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10 room raider ranking when I got on the you know with you. So I think you have everything like well spaced and
obviously. Thank you.
You hit my emotional touch point, so it's all good.
All right. Well, you know, so you're gonna ask me some questions today. I'll ask you some questions. I do want to just generally talk about your bio real quick, if that's all right. So you were elected in 2017, won 86% of the votes. I do kind of want to know just electorally, how the heck did you pull off 86%? Where, you know, that's a lot, whether it's, so you guys have open, these are nonpartisan races, right? Just like our mayor's race.
That's right. They're nonpartisan. Like there's no letter next to my name. I'm a registered Republican. I've been a registered Republican since I was 18 years old, like old enough to vote. Mm-hmm. But I'm interestingly in a city that is registration wise, majority Democrat. Mm-hmm. So the 86%, I think when you contextualize it, is even more impressive because of that. And also, we also have a tremendous amount of MPAs, right? In Florida, not just in Miami, we have a lot of MPAs. I think in Florida, statewide, we're like at 25% or something like that. MPAs, just no party affiliation, meaning that they're independent or not affiliated with Republican or Democrats. And that's why a lot of our gubernatorial races in Florida come down to like 1%, right? Because you got this big MPA. But I think we did it for a variety of reasons. The first is I'm the first mayor of Miami in 125-year history that was born in Miami. Right. So I know that sounds crazy, but I'm actually the first mayor that was born in my city. So I feel like there's no separation between me and my city. My soul my work, who I am, is intertwined with the city that I grew up in that I love. I think number two is my brand of politic is not about, it's not, I call it war, it's not World War I trench warfare, right? Which I think is where a lot of our modern day politics is, right? Like, you know, stick out, come out of the trench, take a couple shots, get back in. And in a year, maybe you move a foot. You know what I mean? I feel like for me, it's not about blaming people for what's happening. It's about solving the problem. You know, I have one of my guys who works with me says, you know, you're not about making a statement. You're about making a difference. And I think that fundamentally goes to doing things that are real, that change people's lives. And I'm not a believer that government is the solver of all problems. Obviously, I was exiled from my country of birth. My parents were from Cuba. I was born here in the US, but my parents were exiled at 12 and 7. Mm-hmm. And, you know, our origin story is a lot like many people who were exiled from communist countries, right? This idea that a leader said, hey, just give me all your property, give me all your businesses, and don't worry, we'll make everybody equal. And they did. They made everybody equally miserable, right? So, you know, equal poverty, equal misery, equal lack of food, equal lack of opportunity, equal lack of hope, right? So
it's such a simple human nature formula where if you remove incentives to get better because you know that you're going to be forced into equality after the fact, nobody's going to have an incentive to get better. And therefore, you will not produce anything. You will not create anything. Your production in general will plummet. It is not hard to even to just have an intellectual thought experiment about it. But,
you know what, Congressman, I'll tell you the reverse is also true. That socialism is the easiest sell in politics. And the reason why is because, you know, when somebody's doing poorly and someone's doing well, it's very easy for someone to come and say, hey, I got an idea. Let's just take a little bit more from these guys who are doing well and just give it to you and you'll be happy, right? The problem with that is, like you said, you know what I mean? And you see this, by the way, in American cities. In New York, if you're in the highest tax bracket, which most New Yorkers are, right, you're paying, you know, 54% of your taxes to government. Right. That's mm-hmm. exclusive of sales tax or property tax.
Isn't that crazy?
It's crazy. So, for every dollar you make, you are taking in 46 cents. It is literally insane. I tell people all the time, the government is your silent partner, right? The majority partner, by the way, in your life. So it's
no wonder, though, like if you are taxed at that kind of rate, you know, and you're a New Yorker, it's almost no wonder that you then also believe that the government should pay for your housing, like pay for your healthcare. Because if you're paying that absurd amount of tax, so I do have some sympathy for their plight, but like, I would like them to just agree, like, let's just lower the taxes. You can choose what to do with that money.
Yeah, here's the interesting thing on it, Congressman, is the ROI, right? Like what you're talking about, the ROI, right? You would expect that a city that charges 54% in taxes has no crime. You would expect that it has no homelessness.
Right.
You would expect, like you said, that you have all these options, right? Like all these services, this bucket of services that you're not getting in Miami. Well, right. Guess what? The homicide per capita lower in Miami than in New York, right? Mm-hmm. When you talk about homelessness, we have 640 homeless. In New York, they have tens of thousands, right? And I'm not trying to pick on New York. It's the same with California. Right. And then I think there's an attitude, which is one of the big reasons why Miami succeeded. It's attitudinal, right? There's an attitude. When New York won the HQ2 prize, the Amazon HQ2 prize, they said, no, thank you. So now you're talking about 50,000 high paying jobs, you know, 50,000 high paying jobs. We don't want them. In California, you had an elected official saying F Elon Musk. And he's like, peace, I'm out of here. Right. So why is that a problem? Well, it's a problem not just because it's 50,000 jobs, which is its own problem, right? And not just because you got a guy who's worth $200 billion leaving your city, which is its own problem. It's an attitudinal problem, right? You are what's a signal to the market? The signal to the market is, if you're successful, we don't want you. We don't think you're we don't think you help our city. We don't think you create high-paying jobs. I was watching something recently that Jeff Bezos put out, which was interesting on, I think, YouTube. And he said, you know, Amazon is valued at $1 trillion. He goes, I have 20% of the stock. So I have, you know, I'm worth $200 billion. He's one of the richest people in the world. He said, but what people don't focus on is that I've created four times the amount of wealth for other people, yeah. Right? For, you know, $800 million of wealth for a variety of other people. So
Well, I know what concerns me about that. That's resentment politics. You know, it's this sense of bitterness at somebody else's success, which is a very key driver of socialism. Because I mean, you're right.
100%.
While you and I can do an intellectual thought experiment on why socialism doesn't work, you're right. It's still an easy selling point because bribery is always easy. It's much easier to feel as though somebody else is responsible for your plight and not you. And if somebody in this place of authority is telling you that, well, it's like a warm blanket. It just makes you feel good. And what concerns me too is, you know, like the bipartisan bitterness these days, the populist right, which is, you know, to me, just Bernie Bros with red jerseys on. They might want right wing stuff, but that's, you know, but that's only because they put the red jersey on and then asked, wait, what are we supposed to believe again? Because dispositionally, it's hard to separate them from the very far left. And oftentimes, you know, I've seen a lot of people from the left who there are a lot of disaffected liberals in that camp of the right wing populists. That's an interesting thing that I don't think a lot of people note. And it makes sense because dispositionally, from just a psychological standpoint, they seem very, very similar. Their thought processes are very similar. The way they engage in reason and the way they assess facts is very similar. In other words, it's not reasonable most times. It's highly biased. It's highly emotional. And I'm like, I don't, you know, yeah, you guys maybe have different goals. You're trying to score a goal at different ends of the court, but you're all playing the same game. And it kind of drives me crazy.
I hear you. And what I see, Congressman, is, you know, a lot of times people are like, focus on the shiny ball. And, you know, people are not looking at the actual record of the person, right? So I've seen this with Republicans where, you know, they're focusing on the shiny ball, right? And they're trying to get you to focus on this, but they don't realize they haven't cut taxes, right? They don't realize they haven't shrunk the size of government. Right. They haven't lowered your premiums. You know, there are things that they're not doing that if you're Republican, you should do. Right. There are things that. And so it's focus on the shiny ball. Don't focus on my record on, you know, wasting government funds on, you know, X, Y, and Z. So I think that also sometimes bothers me because, you know, what happens is when you're and, you know, you and I have gone through this, I think when you're an ascending public servant and people find you to be compelling at some level. You know, there's this thought where they want to, you know, people who don't like what you represent want to kill you in the crib, right? Like let's kill him in the crib, you know, before he gets too popular, too well known, you know, he's too compelling. And we'd rather define him in a particular way so that we don't have to deal with him, right? Because we could just dismiss him, get rid of him, and then we can push our own brand of shininess, you know.
Yeah, well, I've noticed that. The knives certainly come out, and they come out from your own side more than anything.
Yeah,
because it's a set of, again, resentment and jealousy. And, you know, we could talk about that at length. I mean, I just think there's a deeply troubling strain on the right that has nothing to do with conservatism. There's a difference between being a right winger and being a conservative. And, so speaking of being a conservative and how that philosophy applies, I think. It's worth talking about that. And it's worth, I think, explaining to people that it truly means, I think, slightly different things at the federal level, state level, and local level.
Sure.
Because a lot of conservatives get sometimes confused at the local level, because we're used to saying limited government shouldn't solve your problems. Yeah. And that's true. And it becomes more true the higher up in government you get. And so it's more likely that you see a bunch of Republicans voting no on more things that are being presented at the federal level. Yet another program that really just mimics the last 10 programs that tried to do the same thing. You know, when Reagan was complaining about the welfare state in the 1960s, we had like 30 welfare programs. That number is up to just under 100. The spending has, I don't even know how many times it's bigger it is, but it's well over $1 trillion. Crazy. The problem has only gotten worse.
Yep.
That's at the federal level. But one of the things we often say as conservatives is, you know, you got to push that problem solving down to the local level. You got to ask first, should government solve it? Okay, so once you've answered that, so what if the answer is yes? It's a problem that the market itself doesn't solve, that it furthers the well-being of society if we solve the problem. The free market won't necessarily solve homelessness. And maybe we might look at that as an example, because I am really curious into how you get your homelessness
levels. Talk about that. Yep.
And so how do you discern you know, what you're supposed to solve and what you're not supposed to solve. And then convince conservatives like, guys, this is where as a conservative, this is where we're supposed to use government here at the local level. I mean, and it's, I'm wondering what the framework is on how you might assess that, and then and we could maybe we could dive into homelessness as a
sure. So I would break it up into two parts. The first part is what's our formula for success, right? So our formula for success is we keep taxes low. So I reduced taxes to the lowest level in recorded history. So we've never had a lower tax rate than we do now in Miami. And what's happened?
What kind of taxes do you guys have? Do you have income taxes?
We have no income tax. We have no income tax. The state has a sales tax. We don't get any. We get a little pass through on that, but not much. We have a property tax. That's the only thing that we have, and we charge about 7.5 percent of 1%. Right. So we're at 7.5 or 75 basis points. Right. Of 100 basis points, which is 1%. Right. So that's what we charge. So it's very, very little. That's all we charge. We've reduced it to the lowest level in history. And our city's growing tremendously. So we grew last year 12%, which is the second most in recorded history. So my budget's actually growing, even though I'm reducing taxes. Right. And the reason why is because I have new construction and property values are appreciating. Right. So that's what happens when you have a healthy ecosystem. What do we do with that? You go to part B, which is how do you spend your money, to your point, right? So one of the things we did that other cities didn't do is there was this silly defund police movement, right? We did the opposite. We increased funding for police. We supported our law enforcement officers who have, by the way, the hardest job in America, right? Because there isn't a profession where people get paid less money with more scrutiny and more responsibility, right? And so shocking correlation, we have more officers than we ever had. Shock. I'm going to shock you with this correlation, right? We're on the precipice. If we end the year at the current pace that we're on, I'm knocking on wood, of ending the year with the lowest homicide rate per capita ever, ever. So you're talking about lowest taxes, lowest crime. And then the last thing is we lean into innovation. We understand that there is this metamorphosis of our economy from highly industrial to ever increasingly more digital. Right. And so we want to kind of catch that wave. If you look at it, if you think of it as like a wave, right, we want to catch that wave on the surfboard and we want to ride it into prosperity. Right. So we're number one in the nation in wage growth. We're number one in the nation in tech job growth. Right? Nobody would have ever thought Miami, a tech city, you know, tech job growth city. So what we've done is we've leveraged this moment where people are fleeing, you know, California, Illinois and New York. And we are, you know, while those two places were kicking people out, right? Like Elon and Amazon. I answered the question of what if we move Silicon Valley to Miami with a simple answer of how can I help? So I want to roll out the red carpet. I want to, and you know, what's interesting, I think you'll find this interesting, but probably not surprising, is I got a lot of heat. I got some heat from, you know, what many would consider the liberal side of the media with like, wait a second, why aren't you focusing on affordable housing? Wait a second, why are you focusing on? And I said, no, I am. I spent, you know, by the way, I can walk and chew gum at the same time, right? Like I am focusing on those things, but I'm also trying to help people fish. I'm not just giving them a fish. You know what I mean? I'm trying to help empower them. And when did it become controversial to help people find prosperity, right? Like, I don't understand this. And so to your sort of second part of the question is, when is government intervention appropriate and correct? And my answer would be that it's appropriate in certain circumstances, but you should always seek as a leader to get private sector leverage. Okay, what do I mean by that? Affordable housing. So on affordable housing, we do tax credit deals, which are either 4% or 9% federally taxed, federally funded tax credit deals, right? So what happens when we give a dollar? First of all, it's not a stick approach. We don't tell people you have to do this, right? We tell them, this is the carrot that I'm going to give you. I'm going to give you a dollar. You're going to put $15 or $20 of your capital stack, right? Whether it's loan, equity, and other grants, and you're going to provide housing, and that housing is going to remain at a certain price level for a certain period of time. That's it. And we do it completely by the carrot approach. So for every dollar that we put in affordable housing, we get a 15-to-1, 20-to-1 leverage ratio. So if we spend $200 or $300 million on affordable housing, we're going to get $4.5 billion to $6 billion worth of product for the $4.5 billion. So that I think is smart. We did something recently, because I'm really concerned about education and trying to get people STEM educated to sort of be prepared for this new economy. We did spent $500,000 of city dollars. We're not usually in the education business, but we raised $5.5 million So we had an 11 to 1 ratio, right? Where we put in $500,000, the private sector put in 5.5. Ken Griffin gave $1 million, and a variety of other tech companies gave money. The guys that do the Board Ape Yacht Clubs of Yuga Labs gave like $300,000, mm-hmm. et cetera. And what we did was every single Miamian who's a Pell Grant recipient, right? Who is from the federal, you know, FAFSA, you know, process is the neediest, you know, the neediest Miamians who get Pell Grants that want to do a STEM education in four of the universities in Miami will go for free. We pick up the difference, right? So we're not picking, this is not like a debt forgiveness. This is not like some kind of full scholarship. This is us making up that marginal dollar, that marginal difference. And we're doing it with mostly private sector money. So I think that's the way to do that. And then we can get into right. homelessness if you want.
I do. I actually had a question as you were talking about affordable housing, which is, you know, how you deal with the, if it's federal money. So my first question is it's federal money? And if so, and in general, how do you deal with, because the problem with federal money is, you know, it's a double-edged sword. On the one hand, it feels free. It's not free. It's still coming from your own taxpayers, but it feels free as far as your budget is concerned. It is sure. free. But on the other hand, it often comes with a whole bunch of strings attached to it. And with, especially with something like affordable housing, a ton of, and I talk to developers about this a lot, and the amount of requirements to build so-called affordable Section 8 housing is just absurd. And they don't necessarily make sense. And they're like, we know how to build things. Just let us build it, for God's sakes. Just let us build it, get people a voucher of some sort, and you know, they can just move in. That's a lengthier conversation, but I mean, how do you discern whether that you guys should either do a bond sale or it comes out of your budget so that you don't have those restrictions, or whether you should take federal money?
So you know what you're saying, or you're articulating, is an interesting problem, right? Which is, you know, oftentimes you're given money, right, with strings that make the money unfeasible or unwantable, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the problem. But I think what we did in 2009, when I was first elected as a councilman, you know, was we didn't have any money. We're basically on the verge of bankruptcy because of the, you know, real estate bubble bursting. Mm-hmm. And we created a zoning package. So this goes into regulation. We created a zoning package because the federal funding, the tax credit deals that are 4% and 9% are issued through the state. And we reverse engineered the lottery system, which are the 9% tax credit deals. And we got every single lottery unit in the state of Florida in 1 year. So that just goes to show that if you're creative, if you work with the private sector, exactly what you're saying, you work with the developers and you say, hey, how can we maximize our opportunities without even putting in a dollar, right? And that was just basically through smart regulation, deregulating and creating more units per square foot. Which when you put it into a formula that grades where the money goes, it takes it to the top of the formula. So we were so successful in hacking the system that they actually had to reverse engineer our reverse engineering and prevent us from doing that the next year, because we got every single housing unit in Florida. So Tampa didn't get any, Orlando didn't get any, Jacksonville didn't get any. So you can imagine they were not happy. And they broke it up into a zone system. But I think the point that you're articulating is, there has to be close collaboration between the private sector and the public sector, so that when you put out a program, right, it can be usable to its maximum ROI, right? And I think that often doesn't happen. You've got a lot of bureaucrats that are sitting in DC or in Tallahassee or anywhere, and they're not having that conversation. And this is all bureaucratic driven. It's all you know, government driven, as opposed to driven by those people who are going to avail themselves of it for the benefit of the people.
Yeah. And it's hard to solve, because you put out spending programs at the federal level and everybody's paranoid that you're going to waste the money. And so in order not to, quote unquote, waste the money and have fraud and abuse, you add all these restrictions. But when you add all these restrictions, you have the other effect of making sure that the money is wasted, because, you know, you have to spend more of it to accomplish the same goal. That's always going to be a balance that has to be struck. And, you know, and one of the problems conservatives run into is, like, we want to lower taxes. And when we say we want to lower taxes, we mean it at every level of government now. But if you take that to its logical end, you know, but because at the same time, we also want to devolve decision making and regulations and social programs from the federal level down to the state level down to the local level, sure, where it can be tailored, right? That's a general, yeah, conservative kind of thought process.
Yeah.
And so, you know, so the thing is about that problem is, if in theory, if you want to do that and maintain some of the same services, you know, you and do that, but the state right now, in general, states can probably not afford that. And so the question is, what should we keep doing? Should we keep taxing people at high federal income tax rates and, yeah, then transferring that money to the federal government and then down to the state level or lower federal income rates? But you might need to make up that. So this is the problem. Yeah. If, as conservative mayors, conservative governors would have to then, in theory, raise the tax rate at their own state level. People would be paying the same tax in the, yeah, end. But that's a politically difficult thing to transition, sure, to. And I think it's one of the impediments to us shrinking the size of federal government.
Yeah. And I would say this. I think the first problem is we're not even balancing our budget. So our spending is so out of control. Right. When I got to Miami as a councilman in 2009, I had what you call a do nothing deficit, meaning if you did nothing, this is what your deficit is, right? Mm-hmm. Of $115 million on a $600 million budget. That's a 20% deficit in 1 year. Okay. So the expenses outpaced the revenue by a projected 20% in 1 year. And so we had to make a tough choice, right? Who pays that? Right? Who's gonna bear that burden? We decided at the time that our residents could not bear it. We were not going to raise taxes. We did not feel that it was appropriate for our residents who were on the verge of or in the midst of a recession to have to pay higher taxes to basically protect the state, right? Like to protect the government, right? And we felt, and I was the only elected official in that cycle, actually of all the elected officials, we have five councilmen and a mayor. I was council. I was the only elected official not supported by the labor unions. And the reason why was because I wouldn't lie to them. I didn't lie to them. I didn't tell them. It was a funny story. I had an interview with them, and I'm going to quote a movie that you may or may not have seen, but it's actually about a Democratic candidate, which is Primary Colors. I don't know if you ever saw the movie Primary Colors, but yeah, there's a scene, you got to see it. There's a scene where the Bill Clinton character, who's played by John Travolta, is in a union hall. And he says to the audience, right? They're hoping that he's going to pander to them and say,
yeah,
that
he's
going to get their jobs back, right? And he says something, I'm going to do something very outrageous. I'm going to tell you the truth, right? And what he meant was, I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm going to tell you what you need to hear, right?
Makes people very upset when you do that. I do it a lot. It's
very risky. So I did it. Right. And here's what happened. What I told them is, I said, look, guys, we're not going to be able to raise your pensions or your salaries to make up to this hole. We're just not. So you're going to have to take a haircut, and it sucks. But you know what? You've never had to take a haircut before. So this is going to be the first time that you do it. It happens all the time in the private sector. People get laid off, people lose their jobs, and people take haircuts. It happens. Right. So I made the motion to impose salary cuts and pension curves for the first time in the history of our city, and first time in the history, probably many municipal governments. And we balanced our budget. We had dwindled down to 13 million in reserves. Today, 13 years later, we have $160 million in reserves. We have the highest bond rating we've ever had under my mayoralty in the history of Miami, AA+. We're one notch below the highest available, which is AAA. And I think we'll get it before I'm gone. And, you know, look, it's all about financial stewardship, right? So, you know, we make a big deal about what that means, but at the end of the day, it's simple. You know, debits have to equal credits. You know what I mean? You know, you have to have, you know, to use your word, fortitude, right? You have to have the fortitude to make decisions, fiscally responsible decisions, to at the very minimum balance the budget. So that's step one, right? Is you've got to get the federal budget balanced. And I think, of course, it will require policy decisions that are tough and that are painful, but that's what it requires of every person, right? Like, you know, when you're a family, that means you may not be able to go on that cruise that you wanted to go on, or that means, you know, in Christmas, you're not going to be able to go all in and get all your kids everything that they want, you know, at Christmas. So, you know, it's tough. It's hard because you want to do that. You want to make your kids happy. You need that vacation. You want to go on that vacation. But the problem is that every year you've been going on a vacation with your credit card, you know what I mean? And now you've got to rein it in because it's getting out of control. And it's completely out of control. And then after that, then you can have a real conversation about what our tax policy ought to be. I think it's still completely out of control. When you consider all levels of government, as you said, that we're, you know, regardless of a low tax city like Miami, we're still paying, if you add up sales tax and property tax and, you know, and every fee that you pay to government for something or other, I don't even want to know what I pay. You know what I mean? I just have to, yeah. I just pay my taxes, you know, October 15th or whatever, get the extension. It was not pretty, but, you know, it is what it is, right? But I think, you know, I think we have a long way to go there, but if we're serious about creating prosperity and maintaining our prominence as a country, into the next generation, this is an issue we're going to have to tackle.
Yeah. I mean, you're right. Oftentimes it's just that simple. And, you know, the thing about the federal government is you can live with deficits. It's just not these size deficits. There is a formula with, you know, if deficit as a percentage of GDP is simply less than your growth as a percentage of GDP, that's a perfectly sustainable debt trajectory. But we're not even close.
I would argue this, Congressman. I would say, you know, we should strongly consider at some point in this country a balanced budget amendment. I mean, you know, our government does that. You know, every single state and local government is required to balance our budget constitutionally. Now, we could have exceptions, obviously, if we're going to war, if there's a pandemic, you know, there are things that necessitate us overspending. But what's the purpose of spending more money than you take in? You're using government as a mechanism to do things that are beyond, in my opinion, the role of government. Right. Like government should be, let's get these things done, whatever they are, the finite bucket of things. And then everything else, let's let the people decide what they want to do with their money and how they want to spend it, which is frankly one of the things that makes this country so great, as opposed to China and other countries that are run, you know, sort of hierarchically. You know, this is a country of people that actually get to make investment decisions. Right. And risk capital.
I tend to agree. I think a balanced, you know, when people say a balanced budget amendment, it doesn't necessarily have to also mean that it's zero deficits every year, no matter what constitutionally. Sure. It can be a glide path. It can be a ratio, a formula of some sort. Now, sure. the best argument I've heard against this idea was actually pretty compelling, which is, okay, fine, but think of the consequences. And the consequences are this: Republicans are not always in control. We are not in control now. We haven't been in control for a couple of years. And so when we're not in control, what do you think Democrats are going to do if they're forced constitutionally to balance the budget?
Sure. They're going to make bad decisions.
Well, they're going to raise your taxes a lot.
Right.
You know, so like that's the best counter argument I can come up with. We should be having the discussion more, though. And maybe the right answer is like some formula in between.
So here's what I would argue to that argument, right? As I would say, if you don't have the balanced budget amendment, they're not able, you know, they don't raise taxes because they don't have to. They can just print money, right? What I would argue is they're just inflating, you know, the money supply, right? So that you make more money, essentially, and you end up having to pay more taxes anyways because you're in a higher tax bracket. So that's my counter to the counter.
Well, yeah. Well, when they go too far, yeah. Because, I mean, that's obviously what we're seeing in the last couple of years. You got the combination of supply chain glitches plus, you know, which were lockdown induced. I would say those are COVID policy induced. So you can still bring Democrats. We just got to be accurate in how we talk about it. And then second, I think the American Rescue Plan injected way too much money into the economy, and boom, you have what you have. Maybe my last, I don't know if you want to, you can always hit me with
yeah, with I got a couple too, good but, ones. I got a couple. Go ahead. Your last one, and I'll hit you with a couple.
Well, homelessness, I don't know if it's a question, but like,
it is.
You know, we've, I had a Michael Schellenberger on the podcast a few months ago talking about his book, San Francisco and homelessness and in general. And I thought he did some really interesting research in San Francisco in particular. And, you know, he made some important points that I think kind of summarize the entire problem, which is, look, when you lose your job and you fall on hard times, maybe you lose your house and your wife and everything, you don't just go to Skid Row. That's not like, oh, geez, I'm homeless now. All right. I mean, Skid Row, here I come.
Absolutely.
That's not what happens. And so the type of people that end up there are very clearly mentally ill or addicted to drugs.
Sure.
We did away. I'm curious what your thoughts are on this. I mean, in this country, we did away with an old mental institution, state-led, state-funded mental institutions a long time ago. Yep. Ever since One That Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest came out, thanks Jack Nicholson, now we can't put them anywhere. Now they're just on the street.
Yeah,
I'm curious what you think about that. And is there a reasonable mechanism to bring that back and fund that problem? Yeah. Or so, what do you guys do?
So the answer is yes. And what we do, we have 640 homeless right now in the city of Miami proper. And we, about 10, maybe 12 years ago, we created something called the Homeless Trust. And so the trust sits outside of government. It's not a government organization, but it is funded through a 1% tourist tax. So what happens is if you're a tourist and you fly into Miami and you stay at a Holiday Inn or whatever hotel you stay in, you pay 1% in tax that goes to this fund to fund what we call the Homeless Trust. So it produces about $50 million in revenue a year, right? Which is extremely robust. Yeah. And what it is a decentralized set of facilities, right? Throughout the county. So we sort of spread it around so that it doesn't warehouse people in a particular area. And what they do is they get mental health treatment, they get substance abuse treatment, and they get vocational training, right? So the three things that you need to rehabilitate yourself, right? Let's get you on meds if you have a mental health issue. Let's get you off substances if you have a substance abuse issue, whether it's alcohol or drugs, right? And then let's find a way to rehabilitate you by giving you vocational training that you can use to get a job and provide for yourself and your family. Mm-hmm. Right. Then we also do obviously supportive housing stuff. Right. So we're building housing for the homeless. We use obviously Social Security disability and a variety of other income mechanisms to be able to pay for it, the voucher systems, et cetera. So it's very comprehensive. We used to have 9,000 homeless. We now have 1,000 homeless. So we've reduced homelessness by 90%. Wow. Okay. Having said that, now we're at that chronic 1,000, right? And that chronic 1,000 is the toughest 1,000 because they don't want to come in. They don't want to come in. They want to be out there. So what are we doing? We're doing a lot of innovative things. I've basically gone to my network and said, hey guys, blank check, whatever you need, what would it take to get us to zero? We're at 640 in the city proper, about 1,000 in the county, which is the scale is we got about 2.8 million people in Dade County and about 600,000 in the city. So we're roughly, one fourth of the population of Dade County, right? But we have 2/3 of the homeless, right? We have 600 out of 1,000. So we've said, look, blank check, what's it going to take? So one of the things that we did do with, and we actually used ARPA funds for this, was we said, look, we're going to do a pilot for 2 years, right? Because the ARPA funds come tranched over 2 years. So we're going to do, and it's, I call it the blank check. What do you need? Whatever it is, we'll give it to you because we were getting a ton of ARPA funds, right? So we said, we might as well use it for something that we think is really, really impactful. So we came up with something called Functional Zero. So we want to be the first big city in America to have zero homeless. That's our goal, right? And we reached functional zero veteran homeless as certified by the federal government. So I thought, well, if we can get to functional zero veteran homeless, then we should be able to get to functional zero homeless, period, right? There's no reason why we can't get there. And we're not challenging ourselves, right? We're not challenging ourselves to do it. So we funded the system about $3.5 million a year for 2 years, which is just supporting more beds. It's supporting our homeless assistance teams that go out there, the police officers that actually go out there and interact with the homeless, get them into shelter. It's funding on site. Like we go out there to give them. So like, let's say you don't want to go in. Let's say you're one of these people that don't want to go in, right? We will go to you and get you rapidly rehoused, right? Without you ever having to go into a center. If you're someone who like you said, is on the path to homelessness, right? They've lost their job. Like you said, they don't just show up at Skid Row, right? They're kind of meandering in that path where they will eventually get there. We try to intercept them and try to get them back in housing quickly. And then if you're on the street and you have a mental health or a drug addiction issue, mostly drug addiction, and you don't want to come in because you're out of your mind, right? We go to you and we will give you the treatment there in the street. We won't make you come into a facility where you don't want to go in, and we can't necessarily force you go in there unless you break the law, which by the way, we've changed that as well.
There has to be some kind of forced commitment.
Here's the thing. Cases. Because we put this umbrella of services, we actually got sued by the ACLU years ago. And it was very, very restrictive of what we could do with our homeless. population. And because of all the things we've done, we basically said to the courts, look, we got to treat the homeless like everybody else. I can't just walk on the street right now and take off my pants and go to the bathroom. Right. Like, I can't just do that. Right. I'll get arrested. Right. That's indecent exposure. Why, if you're homeless and there's a bathroom within 100 feet of where you are, can you do that? Why shouldn't you be required to walk to the bathroom and go to the bathroom? Right. An encampment, right, which blocks our sidewalks, which we don't know what they're doing inside the encampment. And if you're walking on the street with your kid and somebody jumps out, or, you know, it's a safety issue. You know, and we can't, and what we have to understand is we want to be compassionate with the homeless, but they also impact the quality of life of other people. And that sometimes gets lost in the discussion. Hey, we have an obligation to our citizens who are law abiding, who are working hard. You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, it brings to a broader point about what compassion is and what to love is. And
sure,
if you love your kids, you know, and I assume most people love their kids and most liberals do love their kids. And when they really love them, they keep them within boundaries. They teach them about incentives. They teach them about consequences. They would never dream of letting them do some of these things.
Sure.
Like walking around without pants on and pooping in the street. They wouldn't dream of doing it because you actually love your kid. Now, if you don't love your kid, you'd be like, I really don't care what you do. Right. I just don't care. I just don't, yeah, you know what I mean? Like, you want more money? Just get out of my hair, take more money. That seems to be how liberals kind of treat the American people in many ways and the homeless population, right? They claim compassion, but it's a heartless compassion. And it's a real compassion means you actually care about these things.
So I got a couple questions for you. So question number one, you know, there's a lot of things in your bio that obviously are incredibly impressive. But one of the things that kind of jumped out at me was that you spent time in Colombia.
Oh, yeah. Right?
And I thought that was interesting. And I wanted to unpack that a little bit. And I'm going to take you sort of around the world a little bit to sort of bring it to the question, to get a broader perspective from you on South America and the supply chain, right? Mm-hmm. We obviously have massive supply chain issues. We obviously are too dependent on microchips on Taiwan, right? Which is part of why the chips bill was important. You know, how do we, and then we have increasing socialism in South America, including recently in Colombia, right? When Duque left office and the new president took office, and now potentially in Brazil, we don't know what's gonna happen in Brazil, right? So, you know, to me, I see huge opportunity here, right? We have supply chain issues. We're too dependent on Asia, right? How do we start maybe bringing some of that supply chain to our hemisphere, creating a little bit more prosperity, which depowers these socialist regimes, right? And then it also helps us with the immigration issue because people are coming, want to come to this country because they want prosperity, right? That's what we offer. So how do we sort of put that all together in our maybe generation and deal with like two or three problems at the same time that are national security issues for us?
Yeah, great question. I mean, I'm always, and I'm sure you agree, I'm always saying that our foreign policy needs to drastically shift focus south of the border.
No doubt.
For a bunch of reasons. It's not just because of our border crisis. It's for a lot of the reasons that you just stated regarding supply chains. And look, we're, as we sort of decouple from China, there is going to be this, I think, this natural this regionalization of economies. I think it'll just naturally happen because of world events and a severe distrust in the Chinese, a very valid distrust that is growing amongst the international community, which I'm a big fan of. I'm a big fan of this decoupling because us China hawks have been perhaps saying this for a long time that these people can't be trusted. And I think the business community is waking up to that. But what China has always given American manufacturing is that cheap labor. And I know that sometimes meant for some cities in America, that meant your jobs got shipped over. So that really pissed people off.
For sure.
Are the jobs coming back? You know, Trump promised that it was never going to happen, right? The market still has to be able to feed that mechanism and to be able to incentivize that. That being said, you know, they're replaced with many other jobs. We're going to need that cheap labor to some extent. You know, we have 9 million job openings right now in America. That we do not have an employment problem. If you can't find a job, I don't know what to tell you.
Let me just jump in and say Miami has 1.4% unemployment. And I tell people, according to Bloomberg, and I tell people all the time, that's great until you want to open up a small business, right? And you can't find somebody to power that business, right? Like it's wonderful to have so low unemployment, but when you don't have employees to start a small business, it's a major problem.
So. Yeah. And we are seeing the labor participation rate tick up. I think the whole labor market lately has been just a mystery. I've asked business owners about it. Government officials, nobody seems to quite be able to put their finger on what happened to all of our workers. We can't find them anymore. It's like they just disappeared off the face of the earth. But in any case, you know, everything we pick up these days seems to say made in China. And we would rather it says made in Mexico. It would probably still be cheaper just based on, you know, shipping costs.
Yep.
And we have a much more of an interest in creating employment and develop these countries south of us. I mean, you know, this is now the Democrats annoy me because they always point to this as the real source of illegal immigration and what we need to do. You know, you need to create jobs there, like help them. And I'm like, well, that's true, but that's like a 10-year plan. You know, you still have to have it's like the homeless problem, right? You've got to create the infrastructure to help them, but you also have to say it's illegal to camp here. You have to do both things. This is what Democrats don't seem to understand. And that logic applies to the border. It applies to homelessness. So, yeah, I'm fully engaged in that. And there's some of these countries are highly educated. Colombia is a highly educated country.
No doubt.
Even under this new president, Petro, who's everybody's very fearful of what might happen under him.
Sure.
I think they might crash their energy industry. But the reason I was living down there is because my dad was in oil and gas. So I did all 4 years of high school in Bogota. I got my 20-year reunion.
¿Hablas español entonces?
Claro que sí. Un poquito.
Ah, there you go. Muy bien. Esa iba a ser mi segunda pregunta, pero...
Yo hablo un poquito de español. No como antes, no como... Cuando estaba ahí.
Of course.
Yo también he practicado mucho más.
Naturally.
Anyway.
He basically said, by the way, guys, that he doesn't speak as well as he used to when he used to practice all the time, which is obvious, right? Natural.
Yeah, I can get it back, I think, somewhat quickly, but, you know, you need to be immersed. You need to actually practice it. So, I've actually, in anticipation of my 20-year reunion, I've been reading a lot of newspaper editorials from Colombia. You know, you can't just read the news. If you read the news, it's like, you know, it's news language. Nobody talks like that. So you gotta read the op-eds.
Or watch telenovelas if you want.
Yeah, you could do that too. But I can't. I just can't sit through it. I'm sure we agree on that. It's look, I'm running for Homeland Security Chairman too. So this is I and Mike McCall would be the Chairman of Foreign Affairs in the next Congress. And I think there's a lot of commonality here in how we think about this. You've got to push our foreign policy south. I think the cartels are our biggest national security threat by far. They're you know, killing almost 80,000 Americans a year, pushing fentanyl across our borders, lacing street drugs with fentanyl. I think Republicans are starting to talk about it more, but I think it needs to be a very concerted effort. A messaging campaign that says, look, hey, Democrats, we got a common enemy here. You know, we're not xenophobes. We're not all the things you say we are.
Right.
You actually have to address this particular national security threat problem.
Sure.
And they're just not doing it. People should know the heads of the cartels. People should know who El Metro is and not just Osama bin Laden, right? Everybody knows who Osama bin Laden is.
Yep.
But these guys are killing tens of thousands of Americans. And you know, it's not talked about in that way. It's a serious problem.
So you had or you are on the energy committee. And I think one of the things that obviously is on the forefront of people's minds is rising gas prices. We were heading in the direction of energy independence under the former president. And it seems like we've taken a lot of steps backward. Obviously, the debacle regarding OPEC happening, you know, just a week ago or two. How do you see, I think the world is starting to understand or look at energy differently, right? Mm-hmm. There was, I think, a prism of we need to go to renewables tomorrow. Right. And I think there's a reality or sort of a reality check that's not A, possible. And B, there are, worldwide implications to energy policy that go beyond just energy per se. Right. Energy is fundamental. We need it. Right. But it also creates geopolitical alliances or problems. Right. When you see, you know, Germany's reliance on Russian oil, et cetera. Right. And what's happening, you know, with Biden, the Biden administration wanting to talk to Venezuela potentially. The fractured relationship with the Middle East, all that stuff, right? How do you see, I think we all agree eventually we're going to want to see, you know, a renewable energy source, right? Or through carbon capture and through a variety of other technologies that I think will get us there, but it's going to take time. You know, what is the right coherent policy? It doesn't sound like we're ever talking coherently about anything. What is the right coherent policy to go from point A to point B?
It's not complicated. You laid out the problem pretty succinctly. Republicans have been kind of, you know, on the outskirts of this conversation for too long. It's only in the last few years that we've really started to engage on like the clean energy debate. I know you've done a lot of that at the local level, and
yep.
You know, you focused on better bang for your buck, right? Focusing yep. on resiliency. Like, yes, climate change will happen. We might see sea level rises, and so let's just prepare for it. You know, let's do what we can, what's responsible to our citizens. I mean, that's a great, very practical approach, and I obviously firmly agree with that. But I also want cleaner energy in general. And so, but I'm just not emotionally attached to any particular solution. Now, obviously I represent like a lot of oil and gas workers. So, I mean, I suppose you could call me attached to that in some way. But, you know, I still won't stand for anything that I can't make an argument for. And, you know, the argument goes something like this. American oil and gas is cleaner than Venezuela's. It's cleaner than Russia's, probably cleaner than Saudi's as well. We just have more regulations on it. We have better processes. We have some of the best technology. So that's fact number one. You know, in fact, number two would be you're going to see an increase in global demand for energy and by about 50% in the next 50 years. So the demand's not going anywhere. Fact number three, solar and wind will never meet that demand. It is physically impossible. Just impossible. Even the somewhat modest goals, well, you know, modest is a relative term, you know, made by the Biden administration on renewables and clean energy, would require just absurd amounts of land in America being papered over with solar panels and wind turbines, like entire state of Maryland. I mean, it's just it's completely unrealistic. Fact number four, I don't even know what fact number I'm on. You know, there's a growing collection of data and analysis showing that there's actually a very high environmental impact to these renewable sources of energy because of the materials required to excavate, so electric cars, batteries, because it's like, these aren't rare earth, they call them rare earth minerals. They're not rare. It's just that you have to sift through massive amounts of earth to get it, there's a process, and it's an annoying process. The Chinese have cornered that market because it's very, it's environmentally intensive. And they don't have any regulations, so they don't care. So they do it. They also have slave labor. So they do it all out over there. Sure. It's hard to see how we ever get to the point where we do it here because of our environmental regulations, and perhaps for good reason. But the point is there's a lot of costs here to the environment that are not well documented and are only, I think, just coming out. I mean, I've got researchers at Rice University. She was on the podcast a little bit ago. Who was making the argument that, like, actually, as far as carbon emissions go, you know, I'm starting to see, because we're only just digging into a lot of this, like, you know, this sort of prefabrication and production processes that emit. She's like, I think we're actually seeing that carbon emissions could be higher from these sources. So that's, I don't know if that's true yet, but it's fascinating. But the fact that we're even having that discussion shows, look, we're not having a solid. We're not starting off this conversation with a solid.
It's not comprehensive.
And we're not doing a cost benefit analysis, right? which should be the entire point. Like, sure. if we incur this cost on society, what benefit will we get? Now, if we're going to truly save the world, like if the asteroid is coming, well, then no cost is too high. And so now you understand the psychology of the radical environmentalists, because they've become ideologically obsessed with solar and wind. They're obsessed with it. It is their deities that they worship, and the only way for them to make the argument is to make you think that the asteroid is coming. Now, then you start digging into the scientific consensus a little bit more. There's not really an asteroid. Like there's a slow uptick, but you know, the UN report is not what people think it is. It's not nearly as sensationalist in reality as the headlines used to describe it. And so, you know, there's a problem, but it's not the end of the world. There will be costs. And the question is, are the costs we take to mitigate that problem going to outweigh the costs we would otherwise have? So it's a very simple formula. I guess the last thing I would say on energy is, we should be vastly increasing our natural gas exports and our ability to drill and our ability to transfer it in pipelines to export terminals and get that to Europe, get that to wherever we need to go. One, that'll be a big boon to the industry and create more supply on the market, which will lower prices overall.
Right.
You know, even there's some on the populist right who are like, we shouldn't be exporting any of our oil. That's what's causing prices to be high. And it's like, you don't understand the market very well at all. And just how global commodities work. But, you know, let's move past that. But people from the industry say we could quadruple our natural gas exports if we were just allowed to, if we just let the market do what it needs to do. And the question is, okay, so how does that affect climate change? Well, very positively, actually, because that wouldn't likely, now this is where government foreign policy could come in, that where you direct those exports towards countries that primarily burn coal. So now what are you doing? You're displacing coal.
Exactly. It's a cleaner energy source. Absolutely.
By a lot. And you would reduce emissions globally, because the only emissions number that matters is global emissions. Sure. You could reduce all emissions in America tomorrow and you get less than a degree of change in 100 years. That's the science.
Sure.
And so you just increase natural gas exports. Boom. That's a lot of low hanging fruit, you know? And so our argument is quite frankly, very much a winning argument compared to what the left has proposed over the last few years. And I think I do think Americans are seeing that.
So last topic point, I know we're getting close to the end. We just had a massive hurricane in Florida, mm-hmm. Ian. And I think Senator Rubio is proposing, I think, $30 billion in aid. But one of the things that I've learned in my career being on some commissions that have analyzed, and to your point about resiliency, have sort of analyzed how do you save money prophylactically on the front end, right? And all the studies that I've seen have shown that if you spend money on the front end, you save $7 or $8 on the back end, right? We seem to be having these huge checks that we got to pay, which is understandable because that area is devastated, right? You know, at what point are we going to start spending a little more money on the front end, right? Being a little bit more proactive, and understanding that we could save significant amount of money, our ROI is huge if we do it on the front end, and we maybe even invest a little bit in technology to disrupt some of these storms and their ability to create, you know, what is right now catastrophic storm surge, right? 10 to 15 foot in the case of Ian, if not more, and 25 foot in the case of Dorian, which thankfully didn't hit the continental U.S. I don't think it did. At least it didn't hit Florida. It was over the Bahamas for 2 days, Category 5, 25 foot storm surge. You know, that is, I think, a massive challenge that Mother Nature's throwing our way. And I think, you know, it doesn't seem like we're throwing a lot of innovation at that challenge.
You mean like in terms of resiliency?
Or? Yeah, like in terms of not just resiliency, but like technology, right? Like, we when we had a massive problem, you know, World War II was, you know, we invented obviously something, you know, we invented the atomic bomb. Right. During the pandemic, we invented a vaccine. Right. Like necessity is the mother of invention. You know, when we see these things happening, which are catastrophic, loss of life, loss of property, huge, huge bill. You know, what are we doing on the front end to say, hey, let's harden ourselves or let's come up with technology that can reduce the damage or eliminate the damage?
Yeah. I mean, the conversation is twofold. I mean, it's a matter of investment and return on investment. The most obvious thing is resiliency. Again, like what you guys have done in Miami with, you know, you prepare for surges, you prepare that way for with levees and dikes and seawalls and all, you know, all your typical things. We're doing the same thing on the Gulf here with the Ike Dike that we're trying to get funded and finalized. So, you know, that's a big part of it. It's just, it's your common sense infrastructure. I mean, the only kind of, when we do appropriations process, the Democrats brought back earmarks. And I know that pisses off a lot of conservatives, but, you know, there's an honest debate to be had there. I mean, they shouldn't just be used for, you know, the beekeeping foundation in your local district where, you know, the owner happens to be your biggest donor. Like, you know, that there should be some clear limits on it. But I would rather take that money and use it for flood mitigation projects, which is exactly what I've done. Exactly. And just have strict parameters on that money, because otherwise the administration is spending it. So it's not like the money doesn't get spent if you don't actually allocate 100%. Some of it. And so that resiliency part has always been important to me. And now as far as technology, as far as clean energy, to try and mitigate the long-term cost, because now, Now I also don't like, I think the left oversells their climate agenda, because they're basic. I mean, from hearing them talk, you would basically think that we're all going to have weather like San Diego if you just put solar panels on your roof. And the thing is that's not true, you know? So we do have to look at like what's real and what isn't, as far as the impacts. And as far as storms go, I mean, you know, I think the best studies on storm surges and increase in frequency actually show a pretty major decrease in storm frequency that make landfall by 25%, actually, and about a 5% increase in intensity. And so there is some increase in intensity on the average. Of course, you're always going to like this storm, obviously, in particular, as of late in Florida, was particularly bad. Just like our storm and Hurricane Harvey was just this anomalous situation, a particularly bad situation. We haven't really had anything even remotely close to that. We don't even feel like we've really had hurricanes, major ones since that time. So you just never know. And so we could beat ourselves over the head trying to sell this idea to people that, you know, you're going to create better weather. I think that's a bit of a false promise overall. It doesn't mean we shouldn't mitigate it for the long term, for, you know, but you're really talking about 100-year, 200-year trends. Mm-hmm. So I just think a sense of honesty is really important. And you do that, like you said, innovation. I mean, carbon capture, nuclear energy. These are very simple solutions that Republicans are very much in favor for. You know, you've got to take the risk. I mean, it's not much risk, but you've got to reduce the regulatory burden on permitting and for nuclear power plants. It shouldn't take as long as it does to make these things. They have to jump through way more hoops than they should have to jump through. We've got to get our nuclear industry back on track and just, you know, create these things, you know, create a manufacturing line for nuclear power.
Yep.
That scales out and that gets cheaper as you go. We just haven't done that in forever. Instead, we're shutting down nuclear plants. Environmentalists and all their insanity have been attacking nuclear plants for decades. It's completely nuts. You know, this is sustainable form of energy, for very obviously a zero emissions form of energy. It makes perfect sense. And I always say, like, you know how I know the left isn't honest about the climate change debate? Because they're anti-nuclear. And this is proof to me that they don't really care about the problem, and that they're beholden to this sort of either ideologically beholden or financially beholden to solar and wind special interest group. And, you know, there's other interesting technologies, research out there on hydrogen. Hydrogen really as a form of as the best way to store renewable energy. Because, I mean, one of the main problems with renewable energy is, well, the wind doesn't always blow and the sun doesn't always shine. So, so what are you going to do? You're going to build massive amounts of lithium batteries to store that? That would be deeply foolish. They don't store much energy. And again, we went over how much resources it takes to even build these things. And so hydrogen might be the best way to do that, because you can just create hydrogen using excess power from, you know, when you don't need it from the solar panels, when you don't need it from the wind turbines. And then that power stores more efficiently and can be transported, et cetera. So those are some interesting things there. Depending on your geology, you know, you can look at geothermal. This is what Iceland does. Iceland is purely clean energy, but also sustainable. So they're very, you know, the smart people out there, but also just blessed with their resources. I mean, so they can just tap into their geothermal underground, you know, layers or whatever, and power their one city, you know, very efficiently. Not every place can do that, but you might see, because of all the interesting technological advances in hydraulic fracking, and also this sort of horizontal fracturing and drilling that is now just normal in the industry, there's some interesting ideas about how you could tap into the heat well below the surface and just bring it right back up. I mean, it just, you know, we're a bit ways off from that, but you know, and I think incentivizing that kind of innovation is going to be massively important.
Well, listen, Congressman, thank you so much. I know we're out of time, but I just want you to know that I consider you to be an American hero. I think you're someone who has sacrificed for this country, bled for this country. We're so honored to have you as a congressman in this country. And I would recommend to the audience to read your book, because I think your book makes a very compelling case, Fortitude, about sort of the nature of argumentation, stoicism, and that we got to take kind of emotion a little bit out of this, out of the playbook, and focus on solving problems as opposed to just yelling at each other, which is unfortunately what's often happening in today's modern politics. But thanks a lot for the time. And we got to get you Miami, man, so you can see that this is not a fake background.
I know. I want proof. And it's been great talking to you. We're all very impressed. And I'm glad we can highlight on this podcast too, is the successes of Miami and what Republican leadership or just common sense conservative leadership can bring to a city. I think your constituents are very lucky. So, thanks for being on.
Thank you, brother. God bless.
See you, Francis.
Bye-bye.